Okay. So, not so many people this evening here. One of the reasons probably is because you can listen online, and because you listen online, you don't have to worry about the rain or the storm. But even though you listen in front of a screen, it's never the same as listening to it live. It's really strange, but there's a totally different atmosphere. That's one of the reasons why people do prefer to spend lots of money seeing whether it's a football game or whether it's a concert or anything else. When it is live, you're up there, personal, and there's an interaction which happens which can never be replicated on a screen. And it's one of the reasons why that there is something, you know, they say in Buddhism, like a transmission, something which is much deeper than just the words. It's actually being here and getting just the feeling, the atmosphere. And of course, I was being a very fortunate life, being able to meet some really, really great beings in my life. And a lot of times it wasn't just the talks which you got. It was actually where it came from and the feeling that there was something very, very, very powerful. And it was, you may call it a transmission, not the theory, not even just the words, but just the whole atmosphere of the thing. And that was what was so inspiring. So it's wonderful that you managed to come here today, and it's wonderful for those of you who can find the time to come here for the Waisak celebration tomorrow. Yes, it may be cold. Yes, it may be rainy. Yes, but that just makes it more interesting. When life is really easy, you have a wonderful time. But when it's challenging, that is where you can learn so much more. And this is what I used to call the 70% rule. Because being a school teacher before I became a monk, I often credit that for one of the reasons why I ran away to Thailand to become a monk. Because teaching high school students, 11 to 12, 13 to 18-year-olds, that's enough to make anyone stressed out and want to do something else in life. So I became a monk, I left the world. But anyway, just while I was there, one of the things which I had to do was to give an examination, give a test in maths. And of course, that I'd never given an examination before, never given a test. So I never realized, you know, exactly what you should do as a teacher. And so that I asked the senior teacher, and they told me, why don't you set the exam not too hard, but also not too easy. If it's too easy and everyone just gets, you know, 100%, it's not really much worth. If it's too difficult, so everyone gets 30-40%, then they'll get depressed. They'll think they can't do this. They will give up. They will lose motivation, which is an important part of life. So they said, try to set it to 70%, the average score. So that meant that 70% average score meant you're doing well. You could do that particular task which you were being examined in. And also it meant that the 30% where you failed, I don't like that word, failed, the 30% when you didn't get it right the first time, that's where the teacher could focus on that in the next few lessons so you could actually learn. And I always thought that that was a wonderful metaphor for life. And I always used to call that, I call that ever since, the 70% rule. What it means, don't try to be perfect. In fact, being perfect means there's no growth, there's no learning at all. Mistakes happen. When they do happen, they're not opportunities to hide and think that, oh, I didn't do anything, it's not my fault, why are you blaming me? No, those are the important parts of life where we actually grow and we learn and we develop. If life is very successful, you don't learn very much, you don't grow. But when you have these little challenges, not too much challenges, if you only get 20, 30, 40% in life, of course you get depressed. And you think, oh, I'm hopeless, I'm no good, I'm going to give up, I'm going to do something else. But even there, you must always mention the point that sometimes we do judge unfairly, sometimes we just judge other people, we think, oh, yeah, I'm not as successful as they are, I'm not as good a meditator as they are, oh, they have a wonderful life. But when you actually go and find out what they're doing, sometimes the life can be very, very difficult for them, but they don't show it, you don't stay with them all the time, so you don't really know what they have to go through. So there's many, many people that they have had suffering, they hide their suffering, they don't go around talking about it, but they actually just embrace it, learn from it, grow from it, and become amazing human beings, which is really, really inspiring. Sometimes it'd be great if they did say more about their own suffering, so it inspires other people. But here we're talking about that idea of embracing the difficulties in life, that is a growth area, and it can only happen if we accept that that's part of life. That you don't have to be perfect, you don't always have to get it right, you don't always have to think, oh, that wasn't really my mistake. Somebody blame somebody else for your own mistakes. It's not just transferring the problem over to somebody else. It's actually learning how to own the problem, own the mistakes of life so you can learn what life is really about. And so that idea of not blaming others and not even blaming yourself. Because why do we blame others anyway? It's their fault, it's their mistake. Why is it that we always want to blame somebody else and then to take it out on somebody else? It's because we cannot admit that we, you know, were at fault somewhere. We could have done something better instead of blaming others. So when we're not afraid of admitting our own little failings and faults and mistakes, then that means that we can have this wonderful idea of accepting other people as well. We don't transfer the blame, it's just life. We accept our mistakes, we grow from it, and we learn from it, instead of just, you know, trying to think there's something wrong with me. It all comes back to this idea of a sense of ego and self and pride and conceit, of thinking I'm right and everybody else is wrong, no one understands me, no one is hearing me, no one can really empathize with me. All you're really saying is you're not hearing yourself, you're not empathizing with yourself, you're not understanding yourself. And you're transferring that as a problem to other people. So, why is it we have a difficulty trying to understand ourselves? And the reason, obviously, is to be able to hear ourselves, we have to have this lack of fear about, you know, who we are. You know, sometimes that people just say, oh, that lovely little story, okay, I can't help but telling old stories. That was a story, it was a the story of Nasruddin. He was the Islamic Sufi saint many, many years ago, centuries ago, in Iran. And that after a meditation retreat, he took his students to a fun fair. There was some celebrations in town, so after the retreat they went to the fun fair to, you know, have nice food and play games and stuff. And there was an archery contest. And the archery contest, you'd have 3 arrows, and if you hit the target, you would get the prize. What would be the prize? A little teddy bear or something. So I call it a teddy bear, because I like teddy bears. And if you go down to Jhana Grove, you see you've got heaps of teddy bears over there. So many teddy bears that sometimes becomes my nickname, Ajahn Bear Brahm. But anyway, there he decided he would have a go of shooting the arrows at the target. After all, he was mindful, he was focused, he had the power of lots of meditation. Surely he could do something to win a prize. And so he took three arrows just for a few dollars, whatever it was. And he took the first arrow, put it in the bow, and shot it, and it almost killed one of the bystanders. It was totally off target. And people were embarrassed. This was a well-known personality in the village, in the town, in the district. He was making a fool of himself. And people started to say, oh, give it up. You don't know how to shoot a bow and arrow. And he said, that was the shot of a hasty man. So he put the second arrow in the bow, and he shot it. And that went way over the target. And they said, you missed again. He said, well, that was a shot of a conceited man. And so he put his third arrow. He said, stop, you're making an idiot of all of us. You're a very important person in the community, and you might kill somebody. And he shot the third arrow. And of course, in these stories, always have a happy ending, but a profound ending. That arrow went straight in the middle of the target, a bullseye, perfect shot. And when he received the teddy bear, they said, well, if the first shot was a shot of a hasty man, then the second shot, the shot of a conceited man, who did the third shot? And he said, that was me. That is always a wonderful little anecdote of when it goes wrong, when we don't hit the target, it's somebody else's fault. I wasn't on my game today. I didn't feel well. I'm tired. It's somebody else's fault. When it do hit the target, that's me. So you can see just how ego and self distorts the truth. And what's wrong with missing the target? Is everybody does that from time to time. So instead of denying it, we admit it. We made a mistake. So why not tell other people about it? Which is one of the reasons why I always like it when I tell about my own mistakes. And sometimes you've heard about all my own mistakes. So sometimes we tell about other people's mistakes, which I'm partly responsible for. So I remember I was telling the monks about this a few days ago, and this is our treasurer and people around, because otherwise if I tell this mistake, then they may take action against me. Well, it's okay, they're not here, I can't see them. But anyway, so we were out there doing some business in town, and the driver of the car, which I was traveling in, we had to go somewhere for lunch because we couldn't get back to town, to our monastery, or this monastery, or that monastery. So he decided to take me into this little shop in Northbridge, in Newcastle Street, which sold, he said, the best pies in Perth. So he took me in there, and just after, it was okay pie, not that great, but you know, it was good enough. I'm very easy to please. The only pies I don't like are magpies. Don't eat them. No, they're okay, little magpies. But anyway, that was a joke, by the way. Pies, okay. So anyway, there I was. After we finished the meal, then the driver, he couldn't find the keys to the car. He said, where are they? And so we can't find them. So we decided to retrace our steps, go to the car to see if he dropped them somewhere. You know what had happened? When I got to the car first, the car doors were open, the engine was running, because the keys were still in the ignition. This was in Northbridge. And I don't know what it is. Sometimes if a thief had gone past, he thought, this can't be happening, this can't be real. No one, this must be a trick, this must be a trap. Because who would leave the guard doors open for about half an hour, probably a bit longer, half an hour, with the keys in ignition and the engine running in Northbridge. So that is my way of protecting things, reverse psychology. Leave the doors open of your house. Leave everything, all expensive things in there. And people think, my goodness, you know, no one in their right mind would do things like this. So, you know, they won't steal it. Do you think that would work? Don't try it otherwise. If you get the advice here and you sue us, and then we'll be in big trouble again. So anyway, but so people sometimes they make mistakes. And so you tell other people that, because what that means is that people are being human. And when you accept your mistakes, when you don't try to hide them, you take responsibility, you learn from them. So that means the next time. I didn't actually tell you this story, that some years ago, just the local post office was over in Byford. And you know, it wasn't so busy in those days, that road, the Southwest Highway. So I remember we had to go to the post office. And so I went in there with the driver, different driver, but just the same stupidity. I don't know why I always pick. Oh, that's the driver who took me this morning, is sitting over there, so I better not say this. But we went into the post office, and then trying to get in the queue, waiting for to do the business, and then somebody came and said, who's the owner of that car outside, which is rolling down the Southwest Highway? Because our driver forgot to put the brake on. And you wouldn't believe there was a gradient there. I looked at it, and it's just totally, you know, you wouldn't believe it was going down a hill, but it certainly was, because the car was going down the hill. And so in those days, I was much fitter than these days. I was running after it. The Anagarika, he was just way behind me. I had to run behind it and jump in and put the brake on. It was halfway down, and maybe went 100, 200 meters. And I wasn't the abbot then. In those days, that was Ajahn Chakra was the boss. So we never told him about that. He's probably hearing it now. So anyway, so we all make mistakes, and we learn from those. And isn't it nice when you tell mistakes like that? It makes it human and normal, and people actually, they own up to their own mistakes. They realize they're fallible. You don't need to be perfect to be wise and to be kind and to make a difference in this world. And that imperfection means that you can admit mistakes, your own mistakes, you can forgive those mistakes, and you can admit and forgive other people's mistakes as well. So in other words, you don't blame others. Because all that blaming others all starts from blaming yourself. And not sort of understanding it's okay to make faults. It's okay for other people to make faults. It's okay for people to fall asleep and start snoring during the meditation. Because that wonderful time once, it was in here many years ago, and I was during the meditation, that somebody, they lay down just over there somewhere, and they were pointing their feet at me than the Buddha, which is supposed to be, you know, against the etiquette, you know, in especially Thai Buddhism. And they were laying down there and they started to snore. I mean, really snore. I mean, like an elephant snores, like the train makes noises, like the Indian Pacific when it just gets to a crossing. Like those big road trains, you know, just make really loud noises. It was really loud noise this lady was making. She was snoring her head off, and somebody woke her up. And afterwards, that was my talk that evening. I said, that poor lady, she came to see me before the meditation. This was many, many years ago, she was a victim of quite horrendous domestic abuse. And she came here just, you know, to find a place of safety. And you can imagine just how she felt, so tight, so tense, so afraid, She couldn't sleep at her own house. These were the days before the refugees, before, you know, we had the social services to assist. And she came here and she felt safe. She felt secure that at last no one was going to hurt her and harm her. And so of course, as soon as she felt a bit sleepy, she just lay down and had a nap, which, you know, she needed so badly. And so I always tell people after that, if someone does snore, please leave them alone. Just, you know, they need it. So don't criticize, you have to do it this way, you have to do it that way. That idea of blaming others, you shouldn't do it that way, you know, stop it. That is, again, just not understanding just, you know, how people work in this world and how people live. So because of that, you know, that if people do snore, the only time when it was really bad when somebody was snoring was when I was teaching meditation in a prison once, in a high security prison. And because it was a high security, it was the old one in Canning Vale, I think it's called Acacia now. Is it Acacia? Or whatever. Anyway, they keep on changing the names. But anyway, that when I was teaching in there, because it was high security prison, you had to have a prison officer with you at all times. So he had to come in my meditation group. So as I was teaching meditation, even the prison officer, you know, he was just, well, he was hearing it, so he decided to close his eyes and start meditating as well. And of course, he was the one who started snoring. And it was a very good job I opened my eyes to check, because as he was snoring, one of the prison officers, his hand was maybe about 1 inch from the keys. And as soon as I looked at the prisoner and he did, oh. So that's the way the prison officer are. So there are times when you shouldn't snore. So anyway, that sometimes you have, you know, people make mistakes, we do the wrong thing sometimes. So instead of hiding it and feeling guilty and blaming, I said, oh, I'm hopeless, I'm terrible, what sort of monk am I, you know, falling asleep during the meditation. You know, when I was over in Thailand, you know, we used to meditate as in the jungles. And I would always get sleepy, you know, when I was meditating in those jungles. And I thought, you know, this is terrible. So we had all these little tricks we used to do. Is there some matches behind there? Can you see any matches?
No, two candles.
No. Matches, yeah. Can you get them for me? Because this was a trick. Those have been on meditation retreats have seen me do this. This is because, wow, this is really big. Okay, this will do. So you're always sleeping. When you sleep, you start nodding, you know, before you snore. That was the first stage. So I always trying all sorts of things, methods, so I, you know, didn't get sleep and start snoring, especially when you're with an Ajahn Chah around. So what I did is I put these matches on top of my head, like this. Because the idea was, if you started nodding, you're waiting for it, aren't you? I'm not going to do it. But anyway, it would fall off, and that would wake you up, because you'd hear the sound of all the matches coming out. But what happened, it only took a, you know, that's how I can get some feedback, some mindfulness. But after a while, I put them on top of my head, only about a week of this, and then it would never fall off, not once. It always, and I thought I'd beaten my sleepiness. But you know what happened? I was nodding like this. You can't trust this body, it's just really sneaky. But you know, I felt so guilty about that. You know, I was supposed to be meditating and I couldn't do it and I was falling asleep and just, it was hopeless. But then I always, to tell the other monks, you know, if I'm sleepy, just nudge me or something. But that didn't work either because they were sleepy too. But of course, you blamed yourself, you think you're a hopeless meditator. But you know what happened? What it meant was that one day when I was over in Bangkok doing my visa, and somebody, this monastery, Wat Bawan in the center of Bangkok, they had, it's a wealthy monastery, it was where the king, the royal monastery, they allowed us to stay there, and they had this air-conditioned room. And this was 40 years ago. more than that, 42 years ago, they had a room which actually had an air con in it. And we used to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Okay, these days we only get up at 4 o'clock. We got lazy these days when we come to Australia. But in those days, 3 o'clock in the morning. And of course, no one would use that air-conditioned room in that monastery at that time. So we asked permission, got the key, and we could use that room at 3 o'clock in the morning. And you know, because the temperature was nice and cool, we can make it sort of like Western type temperature, especially England temperature in the winter time, snow time. And if I got the device, I could do it. What happened was you were perfectly awake. No sloth and torpor at all. No, I realized it's just not my fault. I just realized that this body, this was born in West London. I wasn't used to hot weather. And also, in those days, you know, we were sleep deprived, only allowed 4 hours a night, and malnourished, you know those food used to have, frog on rice, literally, that was just one meal a day, and just in a hot temperature, lack of sleep, malnourished. And of course, I always thought, without any disrespect to the Buddha, even if the Buddha was born in London, you know, he would have fallen asleep under the Bodhi tree probably, with all respect, because it was cause and effect, that's all. So, but the thing was, learn how to not blame myself. Made a mistake, that's all. Wrong place, wrong time. When you don't blame yourself and think, oh, this meditation doesn't work, oh, I can't do this, oh, this Buddhism is hopeless, oh, this monastery is no good, oh, this Buddhist society, oh, it couldn't be. All of that is actually the reason why you blame others. It's again because we're just passing the buck. What's really happening is it's our own little problems and difficulties which we're not really facing up, not learning from. So I ask you to find out the problem inside of us. Fix this up. And fixing this up is, okay, you're sleepy. Okay, you're tired. Okay, you know, you snore. Okay, you're fed up. Welcome to the world. So, after a while, you realize it's not fixing yourself up. It's not just trying to force yourself never to nod, or never to make mistakes, or never to whatever, to push your feet in front of the Buddha or whatever. We all make mistakes sometimes, but it's actually learning to own our mistakes, understand them, and transcend them. It is not changing the world, but not changing yourself, but changing your relationship to yourself, how you look at yourself, how you react to the faults of life and also the successes of life. The 70% rule. Don't try to be 100%. If you become 100%, if my robe always stayed on every evening, then I would make it so difficult for other monks. This is one of the reasons why I do allow, on purpose of course, my robe to fall off, so that other monks won't feel so tight and uptight if they have costume malfunctions during the talk. So, when you have a nice relationship to yourself, you know, these things fall off. Oh, you know, sometimes you get a bit fat. You know that somebody sent me, I don't know if they're listening, somebody over in India, they've started a new retreat program. It's in Dharamsala, apparently, in the where the His Holiness of Dalai Lama lives. And it's called Big Belly Meditation Retreats. It said inspired, but apparently His Holiness of Dalai Lama is getting fat too. That's what they said, and inspired by monks like Ajahn Brahm. Big belly meditation. Anyway, if she's listening today, your message got through, and I thought it was very, very funny. And it was where you spend a lot of time drinking chai, which is lots of tea, very sweet, with lots of condensed milk. So the last message has gone through, just how to become fully enlightened with vitamin T, with sweetened, we don't call it condensed milk, we call it samadhi milk, concentrated. What it really is, it does, just, you know, you got your little idiosyncrasies and stuff, you know, just don't hide them. But of course, the reason I do that, it's not because of greed or desire or stuff like that. It's just to make sure you're not so perfect. Because if, as a teacher, because you raised the bar so high, became so perfect, people say, oh, it's unattainable. That you must have been born with a bald head when you came out of your mother's womb, Ajahn Brahm. Oh, you must have been just in your womb practicing jhanas. And just so no, you sort of, you lower the standard. So it doesn't become so intimidating for other beings. Okay, I'm going to get in trouble for that one again. But anyway, that's my life, getting into trouble. But what it... Here it goes again. Come on, stay up there. But what it does mean is that when you have a much better attitude to yourself, you don't try and be perfect. It does also mean you become at peace with yourself. Do you expect the world to be perfect? Do you expect the weather to be perfect? Here it is again. Oh my goodness. Tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, we're going to have our Waisak. And we've got to go outside to do a circumambulation. And it's going to be wet. What are we going to do? Shall we cancel it? Shall we just postpone it till next week? What shall we do? And so, no. We say that when we go outside, if it's really raining, this is a wonderful opportunity. It must be the heavenly beings are so inspired. They are sprinkling us with holy water, blessing water, straight from the heavens. So soak in the wonderful wetness, the Dhamma, which is, this is what we say when we do this. I think I told you last week, that's one of the reasons why I wasn't invited to bless the royal wedding over in Windsor Castle. Because you know when I do my blessings, I sprinkle lots and lots of holy water. And they didn't think that was a good idea for those couple. But anyway, that's what I would do. Get my swish and just... Anyway, over here you don't need to do that. Because maybe on the Waisak, when we do the circumambulation, you get totally soaked. Allow the Dhamma to go right inside of you. Soak it. We know in other traditions, you know, they have like baptism, where they soak people in water. This is just, you know, trying to get sort of understand how the other religions work. Get you sort of soaked in the rain. Is that a good idea? But anyway, it's a relationship you have to what happens in life, rather than trying to control the world. After all, look at your partner in this world. Oh, they give you so much problems and trouble. Are they perfect? But as so often happened, because I've seen this, you know, people, they have these marriages, these relationships, and then one person just, they just pass away, they die. And now sometimes I think, aren't you glad you've got rid of them? And honestly, this happened. There's this lady who used to come here, and she would always just embarrass her husband every time they came here. And I think, somebody may remember. It's George, come over here. George, you stupid man. George. And I always felt so sorry for George. And he was intimidated, he was bullied. He was harassed, and eventually she passed away. And when she passed away, I asked George afterwards, you must be so relieved. He says, no, I miss her so much. It's amazing what we get attached to. When Mr. Trump eventually leaves the White House, aww. You know, sometimes it's like that. Sometimes you have these. I've been visiting some people's houses. Sometimes they're next to busy highways. Sometimes they're next to railway tracks or next to the airport. And it says, how can you sleep here? How can you go to rest here? It's just so noisy where you are. And then when they move, they can't even sleep. They get so used to things. So sometimes you see, it's just not the noise, it's not the politics, it's not. We make the best use of what we have. And it's wonderful just to see just how people can be so adaptive. And that is one of the wonderful things when we stop blaming ourselves. We adapt to life. Whatever life has to give us, we learn how to make the best of it and adapt to it, and just to see what we can make with what we have. It's not perfect, but sometimes we can learn so much, you know, from some of the other ways of seeing. It's not just enduring it. It's not just saying, oh, we have to just put up with this. No, it's actually looking at it in a totally different light, a different way. Just like, oh, that monk, the Thai monk, he was set up, this was a long time ago, a really good monk. He was about to become the head monk of Thailand, and somebody else, politics, they wanted to sort of get him out of the way so they could become head monk. And so they set him up, this was years and years ago, just before I became a monk, and they set him up as being a communist, and that was illegal in Thailand at the time, and so he got sent to jail. I remember reading his little biography, and it was just really inspiring, because when he was sent to jail, he was actually had a wonderful time in jail. He said, I don't have to give any talks, I don't have to do any ceremonies, and all I can do now is this beautiful little cell and just meditate all day. No one bothers me. And I sometimes wondered about that as a very busy senior monk. Maybe that's where I could do my. No, I better not go there. But, you know, it wasn't his fault. He didn't choose to do that. This is the way his karma led him. And he made a wonderful use of it. And after a while, they found out he was set up in. And after two years in jail, I think it was. That was for those Thai people here, Chalkantep Sidimuni and Wat Mahathat. But anyway, after 2 years, he didn't feel sort of. Bitter about the people who'd sent him to jail. He was actually quite thankful. Gave him a nice break for a couple of years. So some of the best times of his monastic life. Because after all, what's the difference anyway between being in a cell and a monastery and being a cell? And actually there's many, many advantages. You know, in a cell in a monastery, you know, you have to work, people knock on your door and ask problems, and you have to come here on a Friday night, and you have to sort of write books, and you have to sort of sort out problems, and there's many, many things you have to do, and people want to talk to you, and then they want to sort of invite you to their house, and then you have to do the blessings, and then if it works, it's great. If it doesn't work, they criticize you, as this one lady here wanted. This lady, she was, not this time of the year, it was in November, she was about to do her first year exams. She was from overseas, Malaysia, I think. Her first year from overseas, and then she asked me to do some chanting. Her exams were coming next week. So I did the chanting for her. Never saw her again. She disappeared. But I heard from her friends. Her friends were coming around and saying, Ajahn Brahm is no good. Ajahn Brahm is a bad monk. Ajahn Brahm is chanting is terrible. Because the reason was she failed her exams. And she blamed me. So, the fault was, it wasn't my fault. A friend said, don't worry about it, Ajahn Brahm. Of course I don't worry about it. And she said, the reason was because first year away from home, she spent the first year, instead of going to the lectures and going to the tutorials and reading the books and doing her homework, she was just partying all the time. First time away from home. Partying. And when the time came for the exams, she thought, I would take care of that. Oh, there's a limit to what a monk can do, so we can't do that anyway. so please. Anyway, so people always criticize you, but you laugh at it and you just understand that you should really tell people, if you're giving a blessing, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. And why is it? Because it's up to you. Just like the other chanting, it's just, now even some, was it last year, they had this soccer team in England, Leicester, they won the premiership, the top team in England. And they said it was because it was owned by a Thai tycoon. And you know what he did? That tycoon, he sent the monks from Thailand in his private jet to all the home games in England. And they built a special room under the stadium where they would do their chanting and their blessings. And this team, I think it was Leicester, they beat everybody. And so I was actually waiting. I was waiting for to be invited at least to the West Coast Eagles or the Fremantle Dockers or somebody. I didn't want no invitations at all. No. But, you know, I've got form there. I did actually once when I better finish off these stories. I can go on all night. But this was the time I got into trouble. I had hid this for many years. I should have just admitted it straight away. And that was with the cricket. Many of the Sri Lankans know this story. I even told this to the last there was a Sri Lankan New Year over in 70th anniversary, was it? Or of independence or whatever. Anyway, in front of the former governor of Western Australia, Quinton Bryce. And she reminded me of this. But fortunately, she's retired now, so I can't get into any more trouble about this. Because it was sometimes people ask, what are you doing going to the Sri Lankan Independence Day when you're a Brit? You know, that's like, you know, that they kicked your ancestors out of the country. So what are you coming to celebrate? So because I support Sri Lanka, their cricket team. Because what happened, there was a cricket match between Sri Lanka and Australia at the old West Australian cricket ground, the Wacker. And only a one-day match. And at lunch interval, the Australians, they were just hammering the Sri Lankans. They were winning by such a big amount. So some of the boys who actually come here, they were helping out at the stadium. They came here and said, Ajahn Brahm, Ajahn Brahm, we've been asked by the captain of the Sri Lankan cricket team to get some holy string from a good monk. And we think you're a good monk. Can you do this blessing string? And so, now, I shouldn't have done this. I mean, it's a ridiculous thing to do. But I blessed 12 pieces of string. Because, you know, one for the 12th man. You know, cricket. I know cricket. So 12 pieces of string I blessed. And I sent them to the ground. You know what happened? Sri Lanka lost. But, because they asked for it too late. But, that was not the real important match. Because that was a warm-up game for the World Cup cricket. And as every Sri Lankan knows, Sri Lanka had never won much before. But this, they had the final. Sri Lanka, this World Cup cricket final. Sri Lanka versus Australia. And you know how much Australians love their cricket. And Sri Lanka won. Against all predictions, Sri Lanka beat Australia and won the World Cup cricket. And that was, any Sri Lanka remembers that, remember the occasion. It was their captain, I remember his name, Arjuna Ranatunga. Because I saw people show me in the West Australian newspaper the big picture of the captain holding up the World Cup and the whole Sri Lanka. They just celebrated, I don't know for how long. And of course Australia was just so upset, they just missed out. But as he was holding up the cup, you know what I saw on his hand? My string. It was my string which was on all of the cricketers' hands there, except the Australians. That was why they won the World Cup, because of an Australian monk. And it took years before I admitted that. Otherwise, I got kicked out of the country. But anyway, I admit that now. So look, Australian cricket team, you're not doing too well at the moment. So get some string. Is that cheating? Anyway, so you do make mistakes sometimes, and so it's the relationship you have to life. And admit your faults. Because you admit your faults, you don't have to be so perfect. And that does mean that you're far more tolerant of other people's mistakes. When you're tolerant of other people's of your own mistakes, and you admit them, it's learning from, then you can find you can live with other people. You don't have to sort of try and make them perfect or make the world perfect or make Mr. Trump perfect. As wonderful as he is, as long as he's somewhere else other than the White House. I would say, may Mr. Trump be happy and well somewhere else. Or whatever. So, in other words, it's don't blame others. Instead, realize this is a great learning experience. Don't blame yourself. Instead, understand yourself. Admit your faults. Learn from them. And then you find it's very easy to live with others in this imperfect world. Thank you for listening. Sadhu, sadhu. Okay, so have we got any messages from the Australian cricket team? Why'd you do that? You're supposed to be an Australian monk. Yes. Oh yeah, sure. Oh, he's over in Chicago, and I was over there last June. And again, he said, I'm likely to go over there next June for a conference. He said, can I come and say hello? No, actually, that's an interesting thing, because when I saw him, his first wife, which he married, that's one of the reasons why he left, didn't work out that well. But you know, he said that it was part of his wonderful good karma that, you know, she was a very highly paid in her profession, and he, you know, couldn't do very much at all. Just interesting, because, you know, he was a monk, a really good counselor, but you can't get any sort of jobs as a counselor unless you've gone through, got all the qualifications. And he didn't have any qualifications. You don't do certificates as a monk, so he couldn't get a job as a counselor. It'd take 3 or 4 years of going through psychology courses. You know, which he probably knew more than the teachers about psychology, so he couldn't do that. And he had a chemistry degree, but that was just so old, it wasn't worth anything. And so the one thing he did get was the job of a maintenance, building maintenance, because that's one of the things which, if you go to Bodhinyana Monastery, or even at Dhammasara Monastery, you know, become very skilled at just fixing things. So he got a job as a maintenance guy in a sort of the Theosophical Society and that was gave him a little way to get a little profession. And so he still does that. He's a head maintenance guy at the Theosophical Society. It's wonderful. But anyway, the wife he married was very, very wealthy. And so when they got separated, divorced, that he got half the assets. And no, he wrote to me. He said, well, this must be my karma, being a monk for such a long time. So good on him. It's very nice. It's a great time together. Anyway, that I did invite him back over to Perth. Well, actually, I didn't invite him back because I knew that, you know, he was, you know, a little bit too resistant. So I used all the wisdom which I've had as a Buddhist monk over these years. I asked his new wife. He said, "Why don't? Is it a good idea? He comes over to Australia." And she said, "Oh yeah, it'd be a very good idea." So that means that he can't refuse it. You never go the straight way, just go round about. Anyway, Wolfgang from Germany, how can we understand ourselves if we are not in touch with our feelings? You cannot feel peace. what are feelings. Okay, you can experience those. First of all, you experience them, their counterpart in your body. If you're feeling really peaceful in your mind, your body relaxes. If you're afraid, your body tenses up. If you're in love, your body feels really nice and squishy and soft. What else? If you're really angry, you're ready to fight. So your feelings, your emotions, they are manifested in your body. So you get to know them in your body, first of all. Just the different states. And you associate that feeling with fear, with excitement, anticipation. Those are the sorts of feelings you can get to know in your body, first of all. And from your body, then you can start to understand where they're coming from in your mind. And that's how we get to know what peace is. It's a great question. You know, not in touch with our feelings. In touch with your body, at least you can get to know that. And from that, you go to your emotional world. But after a while, with your meditation, you can actually learn what is compassion and kindness. Kindness isn't, get better, come on, get better. How long have I got to come and see you in hospital? I've got another job to do, why should I come? You better get better soon. Of course, that's not getting better, is it? That is just, you know, putting your demands on somebody else. That's why, even just the other day when one of our monks went over to, that's Venerable Mudita, he went over to his family in Finland. Oh, may you have a happy flight, if you want to. We don't have to. It's really up to you. I'm not going to control you. So something. Have a wonderful weekend. Have you ever said anybody wished you that? Have a wonderful weekend. Say, who do you think you are to tell me what to do with my weekend? If I'm going to have a miserable weekend, I'm going to have a miserable weekend just to spite you. So what it is sometimes what I think is compassion. May you get happier and well. That puts a pressure on somebody to, you know, to live up to your expectations. So instead, we just have this wonderful, open the door. If you want to be happy and well, fine. If you don't be happy and well, that's fine. So just always be your friend, no matter if you're miserable or if you're happy. So then you actually get to understand what these feelings are. And if you have this beautiful openness, it's amazing. Just you tend to be happy and well. But if you try so hard to be happy, it really makes you sick. And the next one is Mary Poppins from somewhere. Somebody is hiding their true identity. Could you give some advice to someone who is really struggling with staying in the present time and is mainly living in the daydreaming world? Oh, if you are in Perth, Mary Poppins used to have a, if I remember, that used to have an umbrella, wasn't it? So put your umbrella away and just go out and get wet. And you stop daydreaming. You become alive. You know, life, getting wet, just, you know, feeling the wind in your face, going and jumping in puddles and getting real dirty. That sort of stuff is far more alive and enlivening. You know that one of the reasons we do this holy water stuff, you know, sometimes with kids, you see kids come into monasteries and they just, you know, 5 or 6 years old, not all kids, sometimes they don't know what the heck's going on, and you know, they can give talks and chant, and yeah, that's really, but you do the holy water on them, because it's tactile, they can feel it, and some of them just burst out with these wonderful grins and start laughing, and just, they feel, you know, something which is, you know, it's not too cold, not too hot, not too much, and so it's very, that's why the kids, they do this face painting, doesn't matter just what they're painting, just they can feel, you know, on their face, somebody just, the brush or painting something. They become alive when they feel things rather than just through theory. So, as strong as staying in the present time is maybe living in a daydreaming world, go and get someone to paint your face. Or whatever. So you get real and you feel life. Take your shoes off and socks off and just feel the ground. You know, which you're stepping on. So it's amazing just how much we insulate ourselves from the real world. And when we do things like that, it's amazing just you become alive. And life is much better than daydreaming. After a while, daydreaming just makes you really dull. And wonder, what am I doing that for? And last one from Israel. I find myself blaming others for what I'm experiencing. Why? And the blaming others, sometimes it's how we've been taught, it's how we've been brought up. It's much easier to blame somebody else. One of the key Chinese sayings, I learned this, I think must be before I became a monk, rather light a candle than complain about darkness. In other words, complaining about others and blaming others, sometimes we miss other opportunities. Why are people acting like that? Why do people just try and push others out and exclude us? And that's one of the reasons that old saying, or somebody corrected me on it, what it was, is they drew a circle which shut me out. They drew a wall which shut me out. They made a wall which shut me out. Heretic, infidel, something, someone to flout. But love and wisdom had the wit to win. I drew a bigger circle which pulled them in, included them in. There's a wonderful little thing there, because we do make walls, you know, to paid for by the Mexicans to try and keep people out. You can't do that, and then people find a way to get in. So make a bigger wall. A bigger wall which goes around the whole of planet Earth, which goes around the whole universe, to bring everybody in. To bring not just people, to bring, you know, all the difficulties and problems of life in. To welcome things and make use of them, rather than trying to get rid of things. So instead of blaming others, because really you blame yourself. Always blaming. Always not good enough. Anyway, it has to be good enough, because I've gone over time. And that's all you're getting this evening. Otherwise I'd have to charge the Buddhist Society for overtime penalty rates. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed this evening. And hopefully we'll see you tomorrow, or at least on Sunday, for the Waisak celebrations. Very good. Whoops. So we now pay respects to Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. If you wish to stay behind for a little chat or ask questions or complaints, you're most welcome, except for the complaints.
Arahaṃ sammā sambuddho bhagavā buddhaṃ bhagavantaṃ abhivādayāmi Suvakkato Bhagavata Dhammo Dhammang Namassami Supatipanno Bhagavato Savakasangho Sanghang Namami